Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. First of all, I would like to thank George Marshall Center for giving me this opportunity to stand in front of you and share my experience and learn from your experience in order to keep our nations safer. My briefing will include the topics shown in the slide. First of all, Jordan demography was created from Jordanians and refugees, refugee waves since the beginning of Arab-Israeli conflict. Because of that and its location, a lot of people are radicalized by the idea of jihad and the cause of fighting back enemies of Islam. Meanwhile, terrorist groups take advantage from all these conflicts by building their mechanism to recruit as much as they can from foreign fighters, brainwashing them, converting them to threat against their community and their own people. Although most of Muslim people in Jordan are moderate and against radicalism, there are a few of them supporting radicalistic ideology, and they will keep sending foreign fighters, foreign terrorist fighters, for the sake of jihad, not to mention the fanatic takfiriyin cells, which they are always a problem themselves without being recruited. A vast number of Jordanians were recruited to fight with ISIS and burned their passports. The majority traveled to Syria at the beginning of the conflict by the borders, and others after that, they travel through Turkey. According to our statistics, there are more than 3,000. Why is that? Because we sealed our borders. Now I will talk about foreign fighters in Syria and Iraq, the sighting process, the situation now. In general, Daesh is around 30,000 fighters in both Iraq and Syria. It is our statistics. Between 40 to 50% are foreign fighters from 100 countries. Around 20,000 fighters in Iraq and around 10,000 in Syria. Again, maybe you find yourself disagree with me. This is my perspective, Jordanian perspective. And this is what we believe is the situation now. Daesh manpower and foreign fighters, you see and recognize it rises from 2012 until 2015. And this table show you how. We expect Daesh manpower to increase in a few months due to the Russian involvement in Syria. And a decrease in the flow of foreign fighters due to the Turkish security measures on the border with Turkey. Because Turkish security authorities take further operations to the border, and I will show you where and how. Take a look at foreign fighters' recruitment process. In the media, or in the social media, they published a book, electronic e-book, called Al-Muhajirin, Al-Hijra, Al-Muhajirin, or Al-Hijra, which include methods of the way foreign fighters join Daesh in Syria, and this is the link. For instance, the ebook includes following instruction for the muhajir to follow to travel to Syria. You know, what they demand from him to do: buying tickets, two-way tickets. Some of them can go to the countries other than Turkey, to Spain or to Greece or to other countries, and buy a ticket to Turkey. And then he will pass, if he manages from the Turkish authorities, he will go through to Syria. They demand him to rent an apartment or safe house and start communicating with a member of Daesh. Foreign fighter should communicate with someone called Abu Abdul Ali on his Twitter account and still this account operate. And for foreign fighter, he should memorize a cover story. Why you are here? Maybe helping other Syrian refugees. Maybe he is visiting some historical places. You see, foreign fighters flew through the borders in Turkey. All this. Now, this area is sealed for them because, you know, the Turkish territory is from here to here. The Kurds control the border area between Syria and Iraq. They just have this area. And this area, the Turkish authority takes further operations to control the flow of foreign fighters. That's why we expect them to reduce the number of foreign fighters in Syria. This map shows the foreign fighters' route between Syria and Iraq through Al-Qa'im. And this map, other route, Al-Tanaf, close to the Jordanian, Syrian, Iraqi borders. This route had been sealed because the Kurd and the Peshmerga control Sinjar. And this as well, it's closed. So the life of Daesh now is not as prosperous as before. After foreign fighters enter Syria, he goes through a process to determine his qualification to join Daesh. And according to this capability and education, he will be sent to work within Daesh organization. This diagram shows the process the foreign fighter goes before becoming a member in the organization. And we can recognize that there's a few number of training camps, evaluating camps, reception centers. And they drew the line of the life of the foreign fighters. If he is a fighter, he will go to Iraq or to Syria. If he is not, he will be doing something else. I will show you in the next slide. This diagram shows the foreign fighter cycle. If he decide, even he choose a peaceful alternative to fighting, still in his country, or take out by family and his friends to control him not to go on. Or he travel. If he travel, he will be even stopped at the border and deported, or arrest in the route, or go and received by Daesh. They will train him to fight. If they train him to fight, even he stay abroad and fight, even he die in combat or return. And this is our dilemma. If he return, he even de-radicalized or reintegrated, or if he will have no desire to fight, to attack at home. And this is low probability. Or arrest and jail. If he return, the most probable thing that he will now do, he will plot. If he plot against his nation or other nation, he will attack, foiled, his attack will foiled by law enforcement or attack succeeded in doing his job. There are the leaders of foreign fighters in Syria. The first one called Tarkhan Batarjvili. His name is Abu Omar al-Shishani, commander of the northern Syria. The second one in the middle, he is Islam Atabiyev and called Abu Jihad. His name is popular for our security agencies and intelligence agencies. Deputy of Tarkhan Batarjvili from Kyrgyzstan. The third one on the left, he's Shamil Ismailov. He called Abu Hanifa, leader of Abu Hanifa Jama'ah. Jama'at Abu Hanifa is associated with Daesh. Assessment. Foreign fighters are being assigned to administrative positions rather than fighting, which causes some tension among foreign fighters. Many foreign fighters are sent to conduct suicide attacks without their knowledge or are being forced to conduct such attacks. Lots of reports indicate some foreign fighters are defecting from Daesh for several reasons. As an example of that, head of Legislative Council in Tal Abyad, Abu Ali al-Harbi, and Abu Islam al-Shishani, and Abu Taha al-Kuwaiti, who fled to Turkey with $1 million from Daesh. Believe me, my friends, there's a lot of calls from foreign fighters' families. They are calling that their son and their foreign fighters wants to defect from Daesh. We are Jordanian authorities. We cannot tolerate that. So the answer is no. If we catch you on their borders, he will sentence to prison because it is a crime in our law. Foreign fighters are considered a weak point for violence extremist organizations in Iraq and Syria, and there is many, as you know. If they return back, at the same time, they are considered a threat to establish terrorist cells in their native countries due to recruiting, spreading ideology, training, and conducting attacks. Foreign fighters encourage others to join violence extremist organizations, especially their native citizens. The more foreign fighters join Syria and Iraq, the more difficult it is to track them. And we hear that a lot during this week. Foreign fighters are a weak point for violent extremist organizations on the long term. Why is that? Because they are recruited and they bring a lot of young people to work with them. Those young people want to fight. Those organizations need a lot of handicrafts other than fighting. So there is an internal fight through these organizations because they are against the will of the leadership of those organizations. They are working against the will of this organization. So the discipline of those fighters and those organizations are a problem for them. And it's good for us. Jordan worst fears. Jordan live in the middle of the dilemma, in the middle of the hurricane. And if they live in peace, established their state, their non-Islamic state. Sure, definitely, they will target Jordan, because Jordan was the most successful country of fighting Daesh until now. If they get defeated, they will flee to Jordan with refugee waves. And this will give us the third dilemma. How can we recognize them? Please, my friend, don't ask me this question. Because I don't know. We have fingerprints, records, database, we collaborate with our friend, but this will be a problem if one or two of them manage to go on. Third, how can we handle them? We are a tribal society. The family's bonds are strong. And now I told you about the family, the families of foreign fighters. One of them, he told me, his son was sent there. He told me, I will not receive my son. I will declare that he's not my son. If he come back, he's not welcome in my home. Send him to prison. He is a father of one of the foreign fighters. When it is possible to fight their ideology before they travel to ISIS, Jordan has started to change laws. And anyone of the border trying to, he will sentence to prison. I will quote from our King Abdullah. He's the most influential speaker at the region. He said, we Muslims are facing a brutal attack by outlaws, Khawarij, who distort our faith to try to justify monstrous crimes. Nothing treats our religion with more contempt, and nothing hurts the Muslim people more than the action of these elements. And it's true. They agitate sectarianism and sedition. They mislead young people into abandoning their future, and they fanatize their violence worldwide. This violence, whether against Muslims or Christians or minority communities, is utterly condemned by Islam. The majority now of Jordanians rejecting radicalistic ideology and are looking at ISIS as their enemy. So when any former member of ISIS returns home, he will hide from everybody, even from his family. Believe me, this is the situation in Jordan. And this is why Jordan is safe. You can imagine how Jordan is safe. He's neighboring Syria and Iraq, because the people themselves rejecting this ideology, especially when ISIS burned the Jordanian pilot Mu'adh al-Kasas, demonstrating their brutality, so it is expected that they will work secretly under the ground if they manage to enter Jordan. Jordanian government and intelligence agency strategy to deal with foreign terrorist fighters can be identified in several categories. Now, counter information operations campaign, it is media awareness, media programs, and education. We change the education syllabus. Our children will learn how wrong this ideology. There is a bad people called Takfiriyins, and their ideology are doing this and this. We control the mosque activity. No one allowed to cite and to shout with this ideology because it is wrong. Media awareness. We try to monitor social media, and it is important to do that. We do as we can the surveillance to the probable terrorist groups. We create database for all foreign terrorist fighters. Collaborate with our friends. Changing laws. Enforce our borders. Now, it was very important and crucial for us to enforce our borders. Now we sealed our borders. The rules of engagement in Jordan for any approaching vehicle is to through. They fire this vehicle. No one allowed to approach the borders. We put border control and army units with three lines. So it is sealed. We just address a point where the refugee can approach the borders. And this is recognized by a route, by a point, can refugee enter Jordan. And we control them and have a lot of procedures to control refugees as much as we can. Key challenges. Terrorism supporting countries. International collaboration. I think international collaboration is not at the level of the problem, believe me or not. We have a lot of all the countries in the world, the majority of countries of the world, collaborating with Jordan but we need more. We need to rise to the level of the crisis. Methods to change the behavior. It is at the level of scientists and psychologists to tell us the way how to change the behavior of those people. For now, there is no. There is fail to change the behavior of those fanatics. Maybe to take some genes from them, I don't know. Terrorism supporting countries, this is discussed in this week. There is countries fighting terrorism in their vision, according to their national interest. But their national interest does not help the other world, the other countries. Some countries look to those members of Daesh are not terrorists, or some agencies, security agencies, supporting them. I don't know what kind of intelligence service, from where they get the money, a lot of money. If they ask the foreign fighters to buy a ticket or two-way tickets, they give him money. A woman with niqab, she comes to the gate in Jordan city and give her an envelope with $5,000 and a ticket. And she says, this is your ticket. You can fly, because she's a woman. If he is a man, they will give him the money without tickets. You will have your reservation. My recommendation is not different than your recommendation. I recommend why we don't have the international program or agreement at the United Nations level, or what the French authority asked from United Nations to have a resolution, a clear resolution, or agreement between all of us to identify the foreign fighters, to prevent them from traveling anywhere, to prevent them. After identify, adapt the laws in each country to treat foreign fighters as criminals, because terrorism is a crime against humanity. There is a strong view in Jordan that any efforts in the area of reform will not be effective. Finally, it is most probable that this problem will rise in the future after defeating ICE, and will need significant efforts with comprehensive collaboration and studies to deal with this. Thank you all. Thank you very much.